Story 8 of Abaft the Funnel by Rudyard Kipling. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Story 8, The History of a Fall. Mere English will not do justice to the event. Let us attempt it according to the custom of the French. Thus and so following. Listen to a history of the most painful and of the most true. You others, the governors, the lieutenant governors, and the commissionaires of the Oriental Indias. It is you, foolishly outside of the truth and prey to illusions so blind that I of them remain so stupefied, it is to you that I address myself. Know you Sir Cyril Wallaby, KCSI, CMG, and all the other little things? He was of the sacred order of yourself, a man responsible enormously, charged of the conservation of millions. Of people, that is understood. The Indian government conserves not its rupees. He was the well-loved of kings. I have seen the viceroy, which is the Lore Marie, embrace him of both arms. That was in Simla. All things are possible in Simla, even embraces. His wife, mon Dieu, his wife! The hurried imagination prostrates itself at the remembrance of the splendors orientals of the Lady Cyril, the very respectable the Lady Wallaby. That was in Simla. All things are possible in Simla, even wives. In those days I was what you call a schnob. I am now a much larger schnob. Voila, the only difference. Thus it is true that travel expands the mind. But let us return to our Wallabies. I admire that man there with both hands. I crawled before the Lady Wallaby, platonically. The man the most brave would be only platonic towards that lady, and I was also afraid. Subsequently, I went to a dance. The wine equaled not the splendor of the Wallabies, nor the food, but there was upon the floor an open space, large and park-like. It protected the dignity of Wallabiscamy. It was guarded by aides-de-camp, with blue silk in their coat-tails, turned up, with pink eyes and white moustaches to ravish, also turned up. To me addressed himself an aide-de-camp. That was in Simla. Today I do not speak to aides-de-camp. I confine myself exclusively to the cab-driver. He does not know so much bad language, but he can drive better. I approached, under the protection of the aide-de-camp, the luminosity of Sir Wallaby. The world entire regarded. The band stopped, the lights burned blue, a domestic dropped a plate. It was an inspiring moment. From the summit of Jacko, 45 monkeys looked down upon the crisis. Sir Wallaby spoke. To me, in that expanse of floor, cultured and park-like, he said, I have long desired to make your acquaintance. The blood bullioned in my head. I became pink. I was ananiated under the weight of an embarras insurmountable. At that moment Sir Wallaby became oblivious of my personality. That was his custom. Wiping my face upon my coat-tails, I refugied myself among the fools. I had been spoken to by Sir Wallaby. That was in Simla. That also is history. Pass now, several years, to the day before yesterday. This also is history, farcical, immense, tragicomic, but true. Know you the Tottenham Cart Road? Here lives Maple, who sells washing appliances and tables of exotic legs. Here voyages also an omnibus proletariat, that is to say, for one penny. Twopence is the refined volupté of the aristocrat. I am of the people. Entre nous, the connection is not desired by us. The people address to me epithets, entirely unprintable. I reply that they should wash. The situation is strained. Hence the strike docks and the demonstrations laborious. Upon the funesta tumbrel of the proletariat I take my seat. I demand air outside upon the roof. I will have all my penny. The tumbrel advances. A man, aged, loses his equilibrium and deposits himself into my lap. Following the custom of the brutal Londoner, I demand the devil where he shoves himself. He apologizes supplicatorily. I grunt. Encore the tumbril shakes herself. I appropriate the desired seat of the old man. The conducteur cries to loud voice, "Fare, Governor!" He produces one penny. A reminiscence phantasmal provokes itself. I beat him on the back. It is Sir Wollobie, the ex-everything. Also the ex-everything else. Figure you the situation. He clasps my hand. As a child clasps the hand of its nurse. He demands of me particular renseignements of my health. It is to him a matter important. Other time he regulated the health of 45 millions. I riposte. I inquire of his liver, his pancreas, his abdomen. The sacred internals of Sir Wollobie. He has them all, and they all make him ill. He is very lonely. He speaks of his wife. There is no Lady Wollobie, but a woman in a flat in Bayswater who cries in her sleep for more curricles. He does not say this, but I understand. He derides the Council of the Indian Office. He imprecates the government. He curses the journals. He has a club. He curses that club. Females with teeth monstrous explain to him the theory of government. Men of long hair, the psychologues of the paint-pots, correct him tenderly, but from above. He has known of the actualities of life, death, power, responsibility, honor, the good accomplished, the effacement of wrong for 40 years. There remains to him a seat in a penny bus. If I do not take him from that. I wrap my heels on the knife-board. I sing tra-la-la. I am also well-disposed to larms. He curbs himself underneath an ulster, and he damns the fog to eternity. He wills not that I leave him. He desires that I come to dinner. I am grave. I think upon Lady Wollobie, shorn of chaprassies at the club, not in Bayswater. I accept. He will bore me effusively, but I have taken his seat. He descends from the tumbril of his humiliation, and the street hawker rolls a barrow up his waistcoat. Then intervenes the fog, dense, impenetrable, hopeless, without end. It is because of the fog that there is a drop upon the end of my nose, so chiseled. Gentlemen, the governors, the lieutenant governors, and the commissionaires, behold the doom prepared. I am descended to the gates of your life and death, which is Brompton or Bayswater. You do not believe? You will try the constituencies when you return? Is it not so? You will fail, as others failed. Your seat waits you on the top of an omnibus proletariat. I shall be there. You will embrace me as a shipwrecked man embraces a log. You will be damn glad to see me. I shall grin. O life, O death, O power, O toil, O hope, O stars, O honor, O lodgings, O fog, O omnibuses, O despair, O skittles. End of story 8.